We present the effect of complete shipment in container loading problems. Ivan?
Okay. Do you see the presentation? Yes?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Well, so thank you, Maite. And thank you to the organization for this meeting and for letting me to present this talk. Well, this is a work that was made together with Maite Alonso and Ramón Álvarez and Francisco Parreño. On this work, we analyze the impact of the complete shipment constraint in the container loading problem. And for that, we use a VNS algorithm that was presented by Parreño et al. In a previous work. This algorithm is made for the original container loading problem without the complete shipment constraint. So we are going to adapt or use some parts of this algorithm to introduce the complete shipment constraint. And at the end, we will see some results of the study. So the container loading problem is a three-dimensional packing problem in which we have a big container and we want to fill it with some boxes so that the empty space is minimized. And this problem has sometimes associated some constraints like orientations of the boxes or orthogonality. And there are also other restrictions that are called in the literature logistic constraints. And we are going to see in concrete the impact of the complete shipment constraint. So this constraint makes a little modification in the definition of the problem because now boxes are grouped in what we call orders or clients. So in this case, if one box of an order are loaded in the container, then we must to load all the boxes of that order. So here in this bidimensional example, we have on top the logical step if what we want is only minimize the empty space. So we take the bigger box. But in this case, with the complete shipment constraint, what we want first of all is complete the orders inside the container. So the correct step is to introduce the orange box to complete the order. Because I don't say it, but here each color represents an order. So, as I said, we have a variable neighborhood search algorithm to solve the problem without the complete shipment. This algorithm is described in three different parts. The first one, the constructive algorithm, based on maximal spaces algorithm. And when we have a solution with this constructive algorithm, we apply the shaking phase and finally a variable neighborhood descent. To these two last phases of the algorithm, we have some neighborhoods defined from five different movements that consist in removing boxes and reconstructing the solution. And also in the original variable neighborhood search, the algorithm constructs only boxes forming layers or columns with identical boxes in the same orientation. And now we allow to construct other type of blocks consisting on different types of boxes, or even like we can see here in the third example, the same type of box but in different orientations. Because we want to improve the previous results of the VNS algorithm. So now with this algorithm, we want to use it to introduce the complete shipment restriction. And for that, we have two main ideas. The first one is assign the order to each box from the beginning. So at each step of the algorithm, we know exactly which orders are complete in the truck or in the container and which orders are not. So we can use the algorithm to try to complete the orders that are incomplete in the spool. Here we have an example. We have the four different orders. Each one is, each color is an order, and we use the algorithm to load only complete the orders. And the other idea is the opposite idea is first of all, not consider the complete shipment restriction, use the algorithm in the original way, and then make an assignment to try to complete as many orders as possible with the boxes already loaded in the container. So with these two main ideas, we define four different strategies. The first one is the most logical idea, is based only in the definition of the constraint. So we have now orders and we have to load it completely or not loading any box. So I order or I sort the orders by some criteria, for example, the volume of the total boxes in the order or the number of boxes. And then I start to load these orders one by one. We use in this case the deterministic constructive from the PNS. And here in this example, we have five different orders sorted by volume, and each order has only one type of box. So in the right part of this picture, we can see how we first load the client one, then client five, and finally the second client, the client two. In the second strategy, we also use the first idea, the idea to give the boxes an order from the beginning of the algorithm. First of all, we run for each instance the original algorithm VNS to obtain an upper bound for this algorithm, and then with this upper bound we solve an ACSAP problem to obtain a subset of orders to be loaded in the container. So when we get this list, we try with the VNS again to load it completely. If we are able to load this list of orders, then the algorithm is over. But if we cannot load these orders, we update the upper bound with the total volume that we obtain in the last execution of the VNS when we try to load only the selected orders. So when we update this upper bound, we solve again the ACSAP problem and we get another different list. And this procedure is repeat until we have a list of orders that we can load with the VNS algorithm. In this moment, as we can see here in this scheme, if for example we reach a solution in this step with this upper bound, we are going now to try to recover some of the volume that we lost with this last updating in the upper bound, but by trying to solve now the ACSAP problem with the middle point between these two upper bounds, and trying again to load the list of orders that we obtained with the ACSAP problem. And we do this until we have no more time or until there is a solution that we cannot obtain. So this is for the second strategy. Now, well, here we have an example of a list of orders that the algorithm is able to load, as we can see here in the right part. Now, the third strategy, now we move to the second idea, because first of all, we are using the VNS to obtain a good solution in terms of occupied volume in general, without the complete shipment constraint. So in this case, when we get this solution, then we apply this, this integral model, in which what we are doing is assign to the already packed boxes an order. And the objective is maximize the volume of complete orders inside the truck. So this was our first idea, but we see that there are some solutions that without the complete shipment are good solutions with a high occupied volume. But when we apply this last model, they turn on bad solutions with the complete shipment. So we thought a second phase of this strategy to try to improve the solutions. And what we do in this case is with the incomplete orders, we divided it in two sets, the set of orders to be completed and the set of orders to be removed. With this model, we assign to the unassigned boxes that we get in the last model an order, again maximizing the volume of orders. And this new list of orders we get is the list to be removed, and then we try to pass orders of this list to the list to be complete according to three different criteria that we take randomly for each change of set. So finally, the idea is remove all the boxes of the orders that are in this list and try to complete the orders that are in the other list by introducing the boxes that left to complete these orders. Here in this example, I think we can see it more clear. We have here the sets of the orders to be loaded. What we do first is run the VNS without complete shipment constraint. Then the model is solved, and we take that clients 1, 3, and 4 are complete in the truck or in the container, and clients 2 and 5 are incomplete. So in the next step, what we do is unload completely the client 5 and complete the client 2. And finally, we have the fourth approach in which we mix the two ideas we talked about before, because first of all, we run the VNS without the complete shipment restriction, but in this case, we fix a maximum percentage of volume that we can fill of the container, for example, a 50%. Then, with this partial solution, we solve again the first model that we saw in the last strategy. So we have now a list of complete orders inside the container. The next step is use this empty space of the container to complete the orders that are incomplete in the container. And finally, if we are able, we can try to insert client by client the rest of clients that we have in our list. Here we can see also an example. So first of all, VNS is executed without complete shipment. We have a solution with almost the 50% of the container, of the volume of the container filled. Then here we solve the first model of the strategy three. So clients one and three are complete and client two is incomplete. And in the last step, we first of all complete the order two. And finally, we are able to insert the client five.
Ivan, 2 minutes.
Yeah, I'm finishing. Well, so for the computational study, we use the original instances of Bischofrath and Radcliffe, but we modify it by grouping boxes in sets or in orders. Concretely, orders of 10, 15, 20, 25, and 50 orders. And here in the results, we have a group by the class of the instances. We have the results of the original VNS and with the four strategies we talk. What we can see here, what we can conclude is that the second strategy is the best approach to deal with the complete shipment constraint. And as we can see, on average, we are losing only 1.4% of volume adding this new restriction. And that's all. If you have any question?
Thank you. I'm here. Thank you, Ivan. Ramon, rise up. Rise your hand. No? Any questions? No questions. I'm part of this work, but I can ask you something. For instance, Antonia, no, that's a question. Well, have you measured the effect of complete shipment in the solutions? Or how is the effect? How you decrease the volume utilization for the complete shipment in some of the solution?
Well, I think that the general conclusion is that if we use a well-defined method, as we saw in the second case, mm-hmm. the impact of the complete shipment is not easy to see a big impact, because we lose on average only less than the 2% of the volume. So I think that if we use a good method, the impact is not
Thank you, Ivan. Any other questions? Well, let's continue with me. I'm the third speaker. I try to share my screen that is here. Okay. Are you watching my screen? Yes. And where is my pointer? Here. Okay. I talk about solving the pallet loading vehicle routing problem with a stability constraint. This is a joint work made with Antonio Martinez Sicora, Ramon Alvarez, and Fran Parreño. Now, the problem I want to present is a routing and loading problem in which the pallet of a set of customers have to be delivered by a set of trucks, minimizing the total distance. It's a combination of routing and packing. We got a graph here with a depot and a set of customers. A is a set of arcs with a traveling distance between clients. The product demanded is a pallet with a fixed dimension. The pallets are built in advance, and the demand of each customer is a set of pallets with different weight. Like here. The problem has two main distinctive characteristics. On the one hand, we assign pallet to trucks, strictly packing constraints concerning axle weight, stability, and multi-drop constraints. And on the other hand, split and delivery is allowed. That is mean that a client could be served by more than a truck, like in this case, one pallet for a truck and the other two pallets for the other truck. For solving this problem, we have implemented a model with three variables. IK is one if the truck K is used. XKIJ is one if the route of the truck K goes through the arc IJ. And ZKITP is one if the pallet T of the client E is located at position P of the truck K. Well, about the constraints. The routing constraints. Each truck starts from the depot. If a truck arrives to a node, it has to leave it. If the truck case travels from I to J, then it is used in the solution. Each customer is visited at most once by each route. And for substitute elimination, we use a formulation based on multi-commodity flow, where different goods are assigned to different vehicles. We use a new variable, FKIJ, to represent the flow K through the arc IJ. The flow from a customer to the depot must be zero. The maximum flow K from the depot to has to be lower than equal to the number of customers on the route. What's more here? The flow K arriving to a node I should be equal to the flow leaving plus one if the truck goes from I to J, like here. Here is the flow leaving plus one and this one. No flow goes through the arc if the route does not use in the arc. This is for sorting elimination. For packing constraint, at each position of the truck, at most one pallet can be placed, like this. This is in the position two, is placed the pallet five of client one. Each pallet must be placed once. The weight in each truck must not exceed the maximum weight. The weight supported by each axle, in this case two axles, must not exceed its limit. And the geometric center of the gravity must be placed in the ideal position in these sections, no trespassing the second axle. About the stability constraints, we want to load the pallets without empty space between among them. For that reason, we add three new variables. LKP is one if there is an empty space on the left of a position. Here there is a pallet and an empty space on the left, and here the same. This is to activate the LKPs, and only it's allowed one LKP equal to one in each row of the position of the pallet. The same for the right. Here there is an empty position on the right and here, and only it's allowed two RKPs equal to one. And SKP is one if there is a pallet here and empty space in the opposite row, like this. Only it's allowed one SKP equal to one in a truck. To relate routing and packing, if a truck travels from I to J, it has to deliver at least one pallet at customer J. If some pallet of customer J are loaded on the truck K, the route of the truck K visit the customer J, obviously. And this is the multi-drop constraint. That means the pallet of different customers must be placed in the truck in such a way that the pallet of a customer who is being visited first on the route have to be unloaded without moving the rest of the pallet or the pallet of other customers. Imagine this is the route and this is the door of the truck. If you place a pallet of client one in this position, the constraint means that any other pallet of the other customers must to be placed in the positions bigger than this one. This is positions are bigger or greater, sorry, greater than this one. Here is not possible to put a pallet of customer two, but here is okay. Okay, for this model, we need an upper bound of the number of trucks. We use an adaptation on the well-known Clark and Wright algorithm. The idea is to initialize considering a solution in which each route is visited only by one customer. In this case, we need two trucks for attending the demand of customer one, one for two, and three for three. Then is calculated the saving of joining the load of two trucks if it is possible in capacity and weight. And if it is possible, we join the load of these two clients in one truck. And we repeat the calculation of saving until no more saving or is not possible to join the load of two trucks. Like in this case, this is the upper bound of the number of trucks for these instances. Okay, we have generated a new test instances to cover a wide range of cases from the most pure routing problem to pure packing problem. We have combined three factors: weight distribution of the pallets, heavy, medium, light, and mixed pallet, pallet distribution in set of instances, set A until two trucks, set B until A and B until two trucks, C three trucks, and set D four trucks. The number of customers, 5, 10, 15. The distances are from Berlin 52 GSP, and different demand, uniform demand and variable. We obtain 5 instances for each combination in a total of 418 instances. This is the solution of the model. This is the solution of the model set for set A instances. Here is the number of optimal solution. Column 3 is the number of feasible solution when optimality is not proven. And column 4 is the number of time not even a feasible solution is even found. The model has been run 1 hour. This is the gap, the best solution, and the initial solution. The initial solution is the obtaining by the Clark and Wright adaptation. As you can see, only 5 clients, five client instances are solved optimally. Here the results are really bad, and in set B, the results are worse than in A. For that reason, we decide to do a decomposition of the model. Multidrome and stability add a large number of constraints. For that reason, we decide to relax it. The decomposition idea is every time Cplex branch and bound find an integral solution for the variables I, X, and Z, the stability and multidrop are checked for all the tracks of the solution. If it's not feasible, the heuristic tries to solve it. If the heuristic failed for some track, an integral linear model for packing in a track is called. If we don't get a solution with the model, this set of pallets cannot go to the same track, and the constraint forbidding this possibility is added to the model. Okay. The heuristic works like this. This is a solution of the Cplex branch and bone when the stability and multidrop is not accomplished, and this is the route for this track. We order all the pallets according to the route from heavy to light pallets. The pallets are loaded in order from the door to the cabin. If the axle weight is achieved, this is a solution for this track. If not, we can move the load until the cabin trying to reduce the weight on the second axle. If the heuristic achieve a solution, perfect. If not, all the pallets are introduced in a model for a packing in one track. This model has four variables. UITP is one if the pallet T of the client T is packed in a position P, and this is for the stability. If there are an empty position on the left, on the right, and in the opposite side. The constraints of the packing model are attending all the demand, all the pallets must be placed into the track, not exceeding the maximum weight and the axle weight, the center of gravity in the ideal position, stability constraint, multi-drop, and then the packing this is a feasible or an unfeasible. If it's unfeasible, we add a constraint that forbids the set of pallets of the track cannot be together following this route. And this constraint is added to the relaxing model. This is the result of the decomposition for set P. This is the optimal solution, gap, the best solution, the initial solution of the algorithm, time. The model, the decomposition has been run 1 hour. This is the number of instances that get a split, contain a split. The number of time the heuristic is called, the number of time of the solution for the heuristic, the number of time the model is called, the number of solution by the model, and the number of count that are add in the relaxed model. This is for instance B. For C, you can see the decreasing number of optimal solution, and in D, the same. This is a, now I want to show you a solution. This is a solution that shows the demand of client 3 and 4 is split in different tracks. This is 3 and 4, the pallets. Without the split, the solution have required 5 tracks. As pointed by Archetti et al., the clearest case of advantage of a split and delivery arises when each customer's demand is slightly more than a half the capacity of the track, as this case. For concluding, this is the analyzing of the result. Table 6 contains the number of optimal solution by clients and sets. This is the average gaps. Looking at the table from columns, it can be observed that 5 customers instances are well solved, like here. Even when the problem size increase, the 10 customer instances are quite well solved in set B and C, no in D. And for 15 clients, the instances, the number of optimals decrease a lot in C and D. When you build this table by rows, the instances at B are solved quite well with a low decrease in quality with the number of customers. However, the quality decrease very fast with the number of customers in set C and D. This is analysis, and here in table 8, show a first summary of the influence of the weight distribution on the number of optimal solution, average gap, and a percentage of route in which there is a split and delivery. P2 is clearly the most difficult class with the fewest optimal here. Each track has to accommodate many medium weight pallets, and packing them to satisfy axle weight and multi-door constraint is difficult. And when the weight conditions are difficult to satisfy, many solutions split the customer's demand into more than one track, like in this case in P2. And in table 9, show the percentage time of a feasible solution obtained by the heuristic. by the model of one track or not to find, and then a cat is added to the model. This confirms that packing problems are much more difficult, P1 and P2. In more than a half of the integral solution found when solving the relaxing model cannot be compared in feasible solution that satisfy axle weight and multi-drop constraint. And that's all. Thank you very much for your attention. And now, questions. Aceptar. Okay. Thank you. Antonio.
Well, congratulations on your presentation.
Thank you.
Just two questions. In terms of the weight balance between the axles, you consider it at the start of the depot. You throughout the route, as you start delivering the cargo, you do not evaluate if the center of gravity is within the limits.
I evaluate the center of gravity at the beginning of the route. Then you unload the truck for the from the door. For that reason, the center of gravity is moved to the cabin. And well, I had to check it in an arc or in a journey between two customers. We don't achieve the center of gravity, but maybe only when the first customers only unload one pallet. But if you unload a huge or some pallets, the center of gravity is moving to the cabin, not to the opposite side. For that reason, I think this center of gravity is achieved during the journey, but it's not calculated that in this model.
Okay,
it's not taken into account. Julia.
Thank you. Thank you for a really interesting presentation. I was interested in the benefit of the split deliveries. I don't know whether your data has such large sort of consignments that it's critical, or whether you test data that you could constrain deliveries to be all on one truck, and how much the benefit is of allowing that.
Well, I don't calculate what is the in which instances is better to do an split and delivery to get less trucks to the route. But when the demand is very heavy and the demand is more than a half of the capacity of the truck in terms of weight or capacity or the position, sometimes split and delivery increase a benefit in order to reduce the number of truck. But I don't calculate when the split and delivery is better, or when if not a split and delivery in the demand increase the number of track in this case. But it could be a good point to do, because it's not clear where it's better for a client to imagine. You are a client, it doesn't matter, and maybe it doesn't matter if you receive now one pallet and in 2 hours other two pallets that are transported by other. Maybe for other clients is a problem, depending of.
Thank you.
More questions? No, anyone. But if there is any questions, we finish this third session. If the organizer have to say something.
Sure, I'll say something. So thank you to all our speakers this afternoon. It's flown by. They've all been excellent presentations. And thank you to everyone who has asked questions. questions and contributed to the discussion. So go off and have a nice meal and a nice drink as if you were at an ESA Cup meeting, pretend. And we'll see you all tomorrow at 1 o'clock again. We start tomorrow. We do have another tutorial, but our tutorial is by Viktor Milenkovic, who we haven't seen for a while in ESA Cup, but was a regular attender a number of years ago. And he'll be talking about some geometric aspects in irregular packing, both 2D and 3D. And his tutorial will be the last of our sessions at 3:30. Otherwise, I hope to see everyone tomorrow at 1 o'clock. Bye-bye.